Thank you. First, I want to say thank you to Tim Hammond, Bernd Vey, Mikey Beyer, and Martin Novoa, who all helped tremendously with this process, a lot of translation assistance. The recent German court case upheld a child's human and legal rights to bodily integrity. The ensuing arguments claiming that the decision violated religious rights evidence a misplaced understanding of the proper scope of options available based on a parent's religion with respect to procedures that may infringe on the child's rights. Chronic issues are evident in the recurring tendencies towards balancing harms against benefits, distinguishing male genital cutting as nothing like female genital cutting. Non-judicial entities taking on quasi-judicial roles, we'll talk about that more later, and a dialectic between an appropriately foregrounded child patient and other egregiously foregrounded entities such as parents and society. On June 25th, the Regional Court of Cologne ruled on appeal in a criminal case that circumcision of boys is a bodily injury, and doctors doing it could be punished for a criminal offense under the Non-Medical Practitioners Act. Under the German Penal Code, physical maltreatment was held subject to criminal sanction where an inappropriate and objectionable treatment occurs through which the physical well-being and physical integrity of a person, in this case a four-year-old boy, is harmed. The court found that the defendant, a Muslim doctor, physically mistreated another person and violated the penal code by using a dangerous instrument to carry out the circumcision. Critically, the court found a quote, and when I quote, I'm of course quoting the English translation, fundamental right of the child to physical integrity and self-determination under the basic law, the Grundgesetz. The court also held that circumcisions are not medically necessary and that circumcision is harmful, permanently and irreparably changing a child's body. So the court properly foregrounded the child patient and stressed the irreversibility of the procedure, saying the boy had the right to make his own decision about his body and his religious affiliation. The court reasoned it was not an unacceptable compromise for the parents to wait until the child could decide for himself whether he wanted to be circumcised to mark himself as an adherent of a particular religion. The ruling was already in appeal, so it cannot be overturned. And it was not appealed again, partly because the defendant was found innocent. It was a one-time thing where the defendant couldn't have known the law, so he was held not to be liable. So it's good news the case was a criminal matter and was decided on constitutional grounds with the government as a plaintiff. For now, at least, anyone who circumcises a minor without medical basis is criminally liable under the Penal Code of Germany. Several medical authorities in Germany issued statements supporting the ruling. There were declarations, there were petitions supporting the ruling. Some German commentators, on the other hand, and some courts avoid the implications of the human rights laws and recapitulate trends in the US by falling into the fallacy of thinking that a weighing must be done. Well, a weighing of harms versus benefits, so-called, is exactly what the Cologne court held does not need to happen. Because effectively, the religious beliefs of the parents can not go so far as to affect the bodily integrity of another human being, even if that other human being is a child and is the parent's child. Very clear decision, very strong decision. So the words penis and foreskin do not appear anywhere in the decision, and there's no discussion of the functions of the foreskin. Circumcision has been described as non-therapeutic and dangerous by German commentators in that complications including bleeding and infection and also major complications including death can occur. It's been stated by German commentators to irrevocably alter the penis, and I think some of that was a background to the decision, not only Holmputzky but other commentators, some of whom were stronger than Holmputzky in their opinions. One commentator said, and again I quote the translation, circumcision removes at least a third of the highly sensitive penile skin. Boys are born with a foreskin for a reason. Studies have shown that it provides protection, enhances sexual pleasure, and facilitates intercourse. So the Cologne case did not come out of nowhere. While it's the first criminal law precedent anywhere that we know of, at least, there were several precedents in the German legal system of cases relating to genital integrity. In 1991, there was a political asylum case where an intact Turkish Christian was protected from having to return to Turkey on the grounds that it was pretty much a known fact that he would be held down and subjected to circumcision by the medic in the armed forces there, which is why he had to return to his home country. So he was given political asylum on that basis. Then in this millennium, in 2002, a court in Erlangen barred foster parents from consenting to any surgical procedure for religious reasons. And they emphasized the bodily harm that was inherent in that. And the Nuremberg Higher Court on Appeal confirmed that decision. The same year, the Frankenthal District Court addressed a civil case in which a circumcision led to skin transplants and hospitalization. The court held, quote, the consent of parents to a medically non-indicated surgical procedure performed by a non-physician under non-sterile medical conditions is contrary to the best interests of the child and therefore constitutes a violation of the parents' rights of care and custody. Sounds like something one of us could have written, pretty much. In October 2006, there was another criminal case where a 77-year-old Muslim circumciser was held liable for aggravated battery in a number of circumcisions that were performed. In September 2007 was the final and most well-known precursor to the Cologne case. A Frankfurt civil appeals court found the circumcision of an 11-year-old boy without his approval, but at the father's request, was an unlawful personal injury for which the father may be liable to pay damages. The boy was found too young to be able to consent. There's been a whole flurry of events since the Cologne decision. The Bundestag, Germany's lower legislative body, rushed to issue a resolution asking the federal government to submit a bill, and that, of course, eventually did happen. Before that, however, there was a public hearing on August 23rd where the Ethics Council came out with a compromise recommendation. And it's interesting, I mean, they're the Ethics Council. Their mandate, presumably, is to follow ethics and to guide the country and the governmental entities as to how to follow ethics while being in compliance with the other rules. Well, the Ethics Council behaved more like a legislative body in working out this compromise resolution, which actually violated ethics itself, in saying that the circumcision could happen if there was agreement of both parents, pain management, comprehensive education, et cetera, with no real explanation of how the ethical problems with male circumcision were going to be overcome. On September 5th, Berlin Senator Thomas Heilmann engaged in his own form of quasi-legislative action, introducing city regulations legalizing circumcision, but only if performed by a physician. The regulations require written assent from both parents after being informed in detail about the health risks and proper medical procedures. Then on September 25th, the Justice Ministry released a draft regulation stating that the operation should take place only if parents have been fully informed, which this requirement virtually never happens in the US. Millennials are permitted to carry out the procedure for the first 6 months, and unfortunately physicians are allowed to do it under the draft regulation even after 6 months. The AAP's disgraceful policy statement was cited as supporting this approach, which the AAP no doubt views as a victory of sorts. Probably most unfortunately and most legally questionably, anyone who becomes an adult and is unhappy and wants to sue is, according to this draft regulation, supposed to be preemptively barred from suing. Recently, I just pulled this off the internet a few hours ago, legal expert Martin Burse, is probably how you say his name, B-O-S-E, commented on the problematic nature of, quote, a regulation that grants religious traditions a special privilege and exempts them from criminal law. No kidding. That a regulation like this, whose consequences can hardly be predicted, which I think is accurate, the regulation's consequences can hardly be predicted. Of course, this regulation is likely to go through revision, hopefully substantial revision, before it becomes law or anything close to it. On the positive side, medically non-indicated circumcision is mentioned over and over in the draft regulation. It's almost as if they were putting up a sign, medically non-indicated circumcision. They're ostensibly advocating for it, but it seems they might be protecting themselves so they can say, well, we did the best we could. We wanted to protect medically non-indicated circumcision, they can say to their religious entities, but unfortunately it just didn't work. We just weren't able to push it through. The Justice Ministry was disingenuous in claiming this was done to address the resulting legal uncertainty from the Cologne decision. There was no legal uncertainty from the Cologne decision. The Cologne decision was quite clear. So this was a purely invented rationale for this draft regulation the Justice Ministry put forth. The problem in the government's view, of course, is the Cologne decision did not explain how it was possible to proceed with further medically unnecessary surgeries. The timing of all this is particularly ironic given that In recent months, we've had numerous countries' medical authorities and other authorities advocating for a stop to this practice in Slovenia, Sweden, Norway, New Zealand, Finland, and Australia. The justice ministry thereby violated its charge, showing its willingness to sacrifice justice to political expediency. So this flurry of events has seen officials improperly usurping the roles of other government entities, carrying out quasi-legislative actions, and generally playing fast and loose with their usual range of powers, not to mention playing even faster and looser with the truth. Well, what it reminds me of is events in San Francisco last year when Judge Giorgi barred a duly authorized ballot initiative from ever reaching the voters, taking the choice out of the voters' hand before the issue was ripe for a decision. And its non-ripeness really meant it wasn't appropriate for her to address those aspects of it. In both cases, a sort of desperate quest can be seen to safeguard the government from any potential accusations of insensitivity to embattled minority groups. It is often suggested that the current worldwide debate on circumcision is an expression of growing anti-Semitism, anti-Islamic sentiment, or xenophobia. The truth is that since the atrocities of World War II, there's been an increasing emphasis on human rights, with a growing awareness that children have the same fundamental rights that adults do. Lurking in all this is the claimed contrast between male genital cutting and female genital cutting. As we know, however, according to human rights law to which Germany is bound, the inconvenient truth is that under the European Convention on Human Rights, the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, the German Constitution, and the Convention on the Rights of the Child, boys and girls must be treated equally. Germany is home to around 4 million Muslims and 120,000 Jews. Jews and Muslims, the Cologne court held, as well as anyone else wanting a non-therapeutic circumcision, have to conform their behavior with the law. There's no question of other religious practices in violation of the law being permitted by German law. Ritual human sacrifice, flagellation of a child on Good Friday, can't do that. The child must be foregrounded, not parents, not society, with respect to a decision affecting that child's body. The Cologne court disposed of the religious and parents' rights issues without much difficulty, fundamentally saying that your freedom of religion terminates at the boundary of someone else's body. Under the Constitution, under the German Constitution, quote, the noticeable opposing will of minors must be respected, even though they are not yet capable of consent. If a physician performs a non-medically indicated circumcision on a boy under the age of consent, the consent given by legal guardians has no justifying effect, even if religious arguments are made. The religious rights, of course, should be the religious rights of the child, not of the parents. We don't know what religion the child's going to choose yet. And without effective consent or parental permission, circumcision constitutes criminal assault. The Constitution and the regulations allow parents merely to care for the child and to carry out their responsibility to protect the child's well-being. The rights and duties of parents to provide direction as to their child's exercise of freedom of religion and belief under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, Article 14, are safeguarded. But it should be remembered the rights are to advance the child's interests, not to advance the parent's interests. In Germany, the state's obliged to protect the interests of children even against their own parents. And that's come up in context other than circumcision. It's been protected. So neither in Judaism nor Islam is circumcision required for membership in the religious community. The practice affirms but does not constitute religious membership. When the well-being of the child is at stake, possible alternatives must be explored. One alternative adopted by the Cologne court, and it's sensible enough, is to postpone the decision until the child can decide for himself. So talking a little bit about German law, the amendment of the basic law is deliberately difficult. It requires a two-thirds supermajority of both houses, the Bundestag and the Bundesrat. One avenue that's been discussed has been an amendment of this type. And of course, considering how heated the debate has become in Germany, if the draft regulation or replacement doesn't resolve the issue, or even if it does, it's possible that a test case will come before the court system and will eventually find its way in the constitutional court. If the Bundestag does pass any sort of pro-circumcision bill, it's likely to be challenged in the Federal Constitutional Court as violating exactly the same articles the Cologne Court cited in its decision. If such a law were nevertheless to be declared constitutional somehow, it could then be appealed to the European Court of Human Rights, claiming it violates the European Convention on Human Rights. And they've never addressed that issue. No one knows for sure how they would respond to it. Another possible scenario is direct amendment of the basic law. And again, that would require the two-thirds vote. It would not be subject to review by the Constitutional Court, but could still be challenged by the European Court as infringing the right of bodily integrity. The hurdle is high, but as Martin Navoa points out, by comparison, there was not a single no vote in AB 768 in California. And that bill had two serious problems. It was permanently sanctioning circumcision of healthy minors, and the bill was really poorly written, and that got through unanimously. So the hurdles are not necessarily insuperable here. It's interesting to look at German constitutional history. The basic law was created during the Allied occupation of Germany following the Second World War, and it was followed closely by the Allies, who intervened a number of times to ensure protection of fundamental rights. It was designed to correct the defects of the Weimar Constitution and the terrible, horrible violations that happened under the Third Reich, part of which was done by doctors, as we all know. German constitutional law is much clearer on human rights than the US Constitution, being closer to the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms in this regard. So therefore, the protection of bodily integrity and self-determination under the basic law, which the Cologne Court cited, is a direct result of lessons learned from the abuse of human rights perpetrated by the Nazis. It would be very fitting if Germany would lead, as it in fact has already started to lead, the world to a better understanding of respect for the human dignity of all persons, including children. It's equally ironic that two of the allies, the US and Britain, are two of the countries with historically high rates of circumcision, although obviously Britain's has dropped since then. So despite subsequent events, the Cologne decision may mark a turning point in the debate. According to Rob Darby, the argument is no longer about whether boys should be circumcised for so-called health reasons, but whether any non-therapeutic circumcision of minors should be permitted without criminal sanctions applying. So I see an evolution in the dialogue that's going on. I'm hearing academics, I'm hearing medical associations that probably don't even know what the word intactivist means, making statements that Marilyn Milos could have made, that John Geischecker could have made. And it's a great experience. It's wonderful. The legal principles enumerated in the German court case are sound under American law as well as other countries' law. The Cologne decision increases the likelihood that American courts and other courts may follow suit and similarly uphold boys' right to genital integrity, that there's no parental right to circumcise, and that circumcision is criminal assault and otherwise illegal. Holm Putski said, and I quote, "This decision could not only affect future rulings, but in the best case it could lead to a change of consciousness among the affected religions when it comes to respecting the basic rights of children." Hertzberg said, "Isn't it high time in the 21st century that the, I say it outright, scandalous violation of children's rights finally ends?" Thank you.